Greetings, 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 and welcome to our Monday evening edition of The Silence of Our Friends. It's our happy privilege to be with you this evening. It's Monday evening, December 21st, 2020, and it is the allotted time, though a bit late, and I apologize for that. We have so much going on as far as both of our churches are concerned. Year-end virtual recordings, year-end planning, and having to get all kinds of people together for presentations for our year-end or the closeout of our year has really been a lot. And so it's thrown us a bit late coming to you this evening. And so you can help us by sharing the program. That's a big piece. It helps us to grow any channel, any platform that we're on. So if you would take the time, stop what you're doing now. And if you're over in YouTube world, share the link, subscribe to the channel, and even subscribe to the ministry channel. Type in my name in both the ministry page as far as well as our social media program or our social offering to our community will come up, The Silence of Our Friends, and you may see New Life Interfaith Ministries attached to my name. But subscribe. Cost you nothing, but it certainly helps us to grow the channel. Your comments, your thumbs up and comments in the chat really help our algorithms, and the algorithms determine how we grow. Church is a new media. The world is new. The era has shifted. And so the electronic part of what it is we're doing is very significant. You can help and take a part in that. And for that, we appreciate you. If you're over in the Facebook side of life, if you will, follow our ministry pages and then check in from time to time. And right now, share our program, like our program, make comments, show ideas, personal experiences. If this touches you in any way, please help us to know that. And I try to within 24, 36, 48 hours, 72 hours even, go through all the comments for our program and respond at least by like or sometimes an occasional response from time to time. So thank you for being with us. And this is really important, the sharing aspect because we're a bit late tonight. The Silence of Our Friends, happy holidays to you. Merry Christmas to you. Praying for you and your family and lifting you up before the Lord our God. And we're certainly thankful that we have this time to appreciate him who was born, he who was born, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And we celebrate his nativity and his birth at this time, in this wonderful season and time of year. Last week, we delved into the subject, the making and keeping of a slave. We were making comparisons with the white evangelical church, the black evangelical church, the church at large, the community at large, and this somehow mindset of the master-slave mentality. And we're not finished with it. We're coming back tonight with more information. The church was no exception, as we learned last week, when the church was supposed to be the exception granted by Jesus. And many people would say you have no business tottering or even teetering with any of the affairs of this life, any of the affairs of this world. And I beg to differ with people. Jesus said you, St. Matthew 5, are the salt of the earth, the light of the world, not of the church. And we're supposed to be the headlight, which gives the realization and radiance to the world of how things should operate. Tonight, we're dealing with and delving into the subject, the unbroken master/slave relationship, the unbroken master/slave relationship. And in answering the question, has leadership, the church specifically, but leadership in general, ever adequately dealt with this subject? It's painful for some. It's delicate for others. It's attention providing for others. But it's a subject that has to be dealt with. I was dealing with a situation, I think, when we started these programs. I talked about having a kidney stone. For those of you who do not know, I'm a cancer survivor. All praises be to the Most High God. And I had about almost 50 treatments to deal with the kind of cancer that was in my physical body. My doctors could not tell from whence it came, the function of it. They were quite complimentary in terms of my diet, my exercise regimen, and my lifestyle in general. And so they said I was very young for this kind of cancer to materialize in my body. But one of the things I realized, though the cancer and its treatments were very inconvenient, very invasive, and that's all I'll say about that, it was necessary if I was going to cooperate with the plan of God for healing to manifest in my body. I could have just ignored the cancer. I could have parlayed the cancer. In the consultation, the doctor said to me, we took 12 samples in the biopsy from your body, and all 12 were cancerous. And that wasn't good news. And from that, they said to me, it was very aggressive. They said, you can take some time and do whatever you want to do as far as your personal affairs. But if you don't do something, you're going to die. It was very real, surreal. I don't get into it often, but I'm using that as a parallel to say to people, because something is uncomfortable, difficult, or something that hasn't been dealt with, has been ignored for some time, doesn't make the challenge go away. And we have a cancer in our world called racism, and it's even pervasive in the church, if you can believe that. Our premise tonight is the mentality. I'm dealing with mentalities tonight of the slave and the slave master, in that certain mentality has crept into our world. Actually, these yet to be United States was founded on that kind of premise, that kind of thought process, even though it wasn't spoken without words because of the 56 signers of the Declaration of Institution of the Declaration of Independence, as well as the Constitution of our country, 56 signers, 56, that's the number after 56 signers, fathers and framers of our country, 41 of which had black, bronze, and brown slaves at home. So you could not have had all men being equal as a mindset that was to affect the black, bronze, and brown man. That mentality, the hypocrisy of it, was the engagement through which our country was founded. And for many, it was also the premise of the church in America, because most of, if not all of the slavers, the slave owners, were church members in, if you will, evangelical churches, whether they were Methodist or Baptist or Episcopalian or Pentecostal, so forth. As long as they weren't Catholic, Roman Catholic, they are classified as evangelicals. And these are people who believe in the death, burial, resurrection, and ascension of Jesus Christ being the portal, the way of salvation. Believing that Jesus' work on the cross was the finishing work, which brings man to a saving experience, brings him to the experience of salvation. The Catholic Church has a different formula, but yet the Protestant Church, everything but Catholics that embraces Jesus Christ as Lord, fits into the category of Protestants because of Martin Luther in Wittenberg, Germany, nailing the 92 Theses on the Catholic Cathedral there, questions of the Catholic faith after reading the Book of Romans. And he protested. Out of the word protest was the Protestant Reformation, the Reformation moving away from Catholicism, which was a worldwide religion and still was, but those 92 thesis questions that could not be answered by the Catholic Church resulted in the formulation of the Protestant Church. And when that happened over in the 1800s, you still did not have anyone crying out. You know, that's just 100 years, and probably late 1700s, if I could trace it back, really, in the same era of time where black, bronze, and brown slavery affected America, you had the Protestant Church being developed, but no words about the injustices and the mistreatment, the ill-fated treatment of black, brown, and bronze people in this country, and we still have it today. Jesus said, you shall know the truth, St. John chapter 8. And we love Jesus. We're celebrating his birthday, not yours. We give him our gifts of adoration, and we exchange gifts with others because it signifies our belief in our fundamental love for Jesus Christ coming into the world. We celebrate that this time of year. How is it that with the celebration of Jesus Christ, with the acceptance of Jesus Christ as Lord, no voices, very few voices have ever dealt with this subject of this master and slave mentality, a ministry of control. And I'm going to get into that in just 1 minute's time. Dr. King says to us, even from his preferably lofty position in heaven, what will be remembered in the end will not be the words of our enemies, but the silence of our friends. And then in another quote, I think he makes from the Birmingham jail cell, letters from the Birmingham jail would be the literary work. There's nothing in the world more dangerous than sincere ignorance and conscientious stupidity. And if ever we've seen a time where both sincere ignorance and conscientious stupidity are on a rampage, that time is now. We've seen conscientious people who are thought-provoking, cognitive thinkers, free thinkers, people who have been trained through the institutions of higher learning, but yet they come to a stagnation, a point of stagnation, stupidity. Then we have sincere people who are nice people, loving people, but yet they're ignorant, and their ignorance causes the blight on our world. I've told you before, I'll tell you again, speak the truth, as one person said, even if your voice shakes. And sometimes with these matters, because of who I am and what I'm called to do, I feel a little shaky. But again, the truth is the truth, and it's only truth that makes men free. In Exodus chapter 10, to the people that would say you're a church pastor, you should just go back to the church and leave matters of politics, matters of civics or civic concerns, matters of injustice and matters of mistreatment and the ill treatment of an entire demographic of people. You should leave those things alone and cloak it, cover it with just love people. Pray for people, and I do both, and I believe that. Remember, Jesus said, I'll give you the keys, plural, to the kingdom. So there are more keys than prayer and covering cancers in the church and hypocrisies in the church and the world with prayer and love. To those people, I would cite Exodus chapter 10. It was Moses who speaks truth to power to the Pharaoh. Moses is a type of the fivefold ministry gifts, those of the apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers, representatives of church leaders who are to be the light of the world. So Moses reflects New Testament ministry in an Old Testament body, feet planted in the Old Testament, but foreshadowing that which was to come through Jesus Christ in the New Testament. And Pharaoh represents the government of the world, the age that then was, the constricting and overreaching, even the political regimen that had God's people enslaved. And so Moses has said to the Pharaoh and the children of Israel, the tribes of Israel, the 12 tribes of Israel, those nearly 3.5 million people represent the church, church and its effect, her effects potentially on the world. So Moses is declared to Pharaoh that God has said, if you don't let these people go, I know you've held them in bondage for over 400 years, 430 years, counting the 30 years that Joseph, who was the patriarch, who walked Israel into Egypt by way of his presence, and then famine comes up in Canaan, and because of that, Joseph's father and the 11 brothers have to come to Egypt, as his vision foretold, for grain. And it was there that Moses rises up and says, God says, let these people go that they may serve me in the wilderness. I have a destiny for them. They've been mistreated and ill-treated for over 400 years, over four centuries, but you got to let them go. And the Pharaoh says no. The political powers that then were said to the church, you are going to be enslaved, and these are darker hued people because this is Egypt, and Egypt is, wait for it, in Africa. Okay, so these are dark skinned people. And so here it is. Moses, the Pharaoh says, I'll make you a deal. The 10th chapter of Exodus, to people who would say, I should keep my nose in church business because I'm a churchman and not try to affect the world around me. The Pharaoh, who represents the worldly government outside of Christ, says, I'll make you a deal. We make no deals. That's the first thing, because our God is all powerful. But we certainly make no deals over people and enslave the enslavement of people. He says, you take the men and go worship Pharaoh to Moses. Worship in the wilderness and come back. I don't know your Jewish habits and traits, but you go worship in the wilderness and come back. In the meantime, I'll keep the women, the children, and your livestock. And Moses absolutely tells him, no, no deal. We're taking the women, these black children, black, bronze, and browns, and our possessions, because God is with us. He was speaking of an equity for all men. Pharaoh was an upperclassman, and this is crazy because Moses was raised in the Pharaoh's home. We'll get into that in another story. And he says, no deals. And the church should not be silent until all people and their possessions are equal with those who are empowered now. Those who have walked in the realms of white privilege, that term shouldn't even be existent because of the effects of the church. But we don't have church people, black nor white, who deal with this subject. And so, you know, this, the 10 plagues are spoken and exacted. And because of that, Pharaoh eventually allows all of the people to go. Here is a glossary of terms, just three short terms tonight. The first is control. It's a very common word, but it's a dangerous word if you don't get on the right side of it. Control. In the sense of the racist mind is the angle and the aspect from which I'm coming tonight. This is the exercising or dictating to another person or demographic the things they should do, the things they should do, think, and act. This is a dictatorship. And we have to be very sensitive to this in the church. As spiritual leaders, we're not called to control people. God has never given any man the control of other people. And what happens in many churches, they remain small, and it limits their effect. Jesus said you should go out into all the world and reach the world for him. St. Matthew chapter 28, verses 19 and 20. But many churches can, and churchmen and women cannot do that because they are people who have control in their mind. A calling is to influence people, not to control them, not to exercise dictatorship over their thoughts, their doings or actions. So in the racist mind, and sometimes in the power hungry and perhaps even power starved mind, people believe they have the right to control other people. That is wrong. The second in the case of three glossary words is the phrase internalized oppression. All three of these words are going to be important for us tonight. Internalized oppression or oppression describes the psychological. This is your morphe, your ability to think and to your cognition. It describes the psychological trauma that ensues when a person from a stigmatized group believes those negative stigmas. It's one thing for you to call me out of my name, to speak pejoratively of me, or to attempt to marginalize me, and for women to have sexist statements made, misogyny, misogynistic statements made about them, the B word, and okay, and that kind of thing. It's one thing for people to portray that towards you, to speak those kinds of things towards you, but it when it is internalized, it becomes oppression because you believe, this individual begins to believe the stigmas. And this is dangerous psychology. And I'm going to get to it in a few minutes. Whatever you're doing, share this message. Don't leave, because I'm going to show you tonight by my research that I believe it has been the cognition of this country, spiritual leaders and leaders in general, to intentionally enforce certain stigmas on people groups, so that there will be this opportunity to internalize those stigmas, and those that internalization would produce a certain amount of control for those particular leaders, at the hands of those leaders. It's very slick, very clever, very sly. And one of the reasons that we cannot be a silent people. Come on, let me hear from you. The third glossary word is that exactly, the word stigma, stigma, S-T-I-G-M-A, stigma. What is it? It's literally a mark, from the literal sense, being made with a branding iron. It's taking the branding iron and enforcing the stigma of, or the brand of, the particular farm owner on the cattle. So if my last name is Matthews, and it is, I might have a brand with the letter M. And to heat that branding iron up and hold the cattle down and stigmatize him by the singeing of my brand onto his flesh. That's the literal meaning of the word stigma. What does it mean from its definition? Any mark of infamy, any undesirable, I might even throw in stereotypical, mark, anything that causes defamation would be a stigma. It's it can be seen in terms, treatments, education, limited education, and even, yes, Jim Crow, separation of black and white. That's that's enforcing a certain stigma that there's one people group that is superior while there's another people group that is inferior. Who can use this message tonight? Share it with them. You're duty bound. You have a conscience with your covenant, a covenant with your conscience to share this message with them. Stigma is any reproachful conduct which, please hear this, which stains the purity or darkens the luster of reputation. You want it again? I'm kind. Any reproachful conduct which stains the purity or darkens the luster, the shine, the potential, the potentiality of the reputation of a person. It limits them before they can get out of the box. There's a stigma, there's a stain which is associated with them, which limits their mobility. The infamous, and I'm not complete working on the research here and my offering to you regarding my research. The infamous Willie Lynch letter gives both African and Caucasians some insight concerning the brutal, inhumane psychology. And if you missed my reading of the fundamentals of the Willie Lynch letter, I will refer you to last week's show. Today is the 21st, so that would have been the 14th, and the show before that, which would have been the 7th, for the complete reading, at least of the first format of the Willie Lynch letter. So this letter, of which I'm referring, or to which I'm referring, gives Africans as well as Caucasians here in this country insight concerning the brutal and inhumane, here it is, psychology, the study of the mind, the mentality, the psychology behind the African slave trade. Now that's a mouthful. The African slave trade was one thing, but bigger than that is the question of what was the psychology, what was the mindset, the intentional and deliberate mentality of those who were slavers, who were enslaving others. It was, yes, treating people as chattel, human owning human, and treating the human owned as property. Yes, it was that. It was heinous whippings with whips, with nails in the whips, the leather whips, with metal in the whips, with beating pregnant women by putting their expectant stomach in a hole in the ground and whipping their backs with lashings while they lay on the ground in those particular predicaments. It was the lynchings. It was what do you call it when you hack off, so to speak, body parts? You're taking limbs away to stop the slaves from running. It was the breaking up of families. It was in part the selling of souls. It was the white slave master taking the black woman in front of the husband to whom she was married and doing with her what he willed to do. That happened after their arrival on this continent. But, you know, and I did a show on this a few months ago, just think of it. You're in the bottom of a ship coming across the Atlantic Ocean in a caged in area in which most of the men or women could not stand. A 3-foot cage, 3 feet off the ground, 3 12-inch rulers off the ground, maybe 4. And a small child could stand. You're seated in your own defecation, your own feces, excuse my moroseness. You're seated in your own urine for days and months on end. People would die because of dysentery, the disease that comes as a result of not having clean environment, and many of them were thrown overboard. They had tools that were black, bronze, and brown people. We're talking about the heinousness of slavery. Would try to starve themselves because the trip, the middle passage from Africa to the Americas over the Atlantic Ocean was so egregious that they would rather starve themselves to death. But these slavers saw them as the economic portion of what made America. You talk about making America great, and they had the reverse of forceps, that they would stick in their mouths metal objects and pry their mouths open and slop the food therein. So you talk about this, you have to also talk about, well, what was the mentality? What was the psychology? What was the thought process of keeping these people controlled once they reached the shores of this newfound land? Regardless of the economic prosperity enjoyed, the inhumane, the brutal and inhumane psychology behind the African slave trade, the materialistic viewpoint of Southern plantation owners that slavery was, quote, end quote, a business, and the victims of chattel, C-H-A-T-T-E-L, the ownership of people as property, of chattel slavery were merely pawns in an economic game of debauchery, crossbreeding, interracial rape, and mental conditioning of a Negroid race. They considered, here it is, subhuman, basically. Monkeys, chimps, apes, chimpanzees, you have it. You get the idea. Regardless of the economic prosperity enjoyed during the African slave trade and the tedious burden placed on the backs of African people, here it is, wait for it. Most will agree that the psychological damage and atrocities inflicted on black people during that point of time and even today are the most outrageous examples of injustice and depression ever experienced by humanity at all. So what do you do with this, church? Church leader, white evangelical pastor, spiritual leader, the light of the world, the salt of the earth, the influencer of the earth. What do you do with this? This atrocity that has never been, I have heard very few messages then and even fewer now that address this hypocritical egregious action, to use that word again. The Black Arcade Liberation Library, 1970, is where I found this information. It was in the interest and business of slaveholders, please hear this, to study human nature. So this was deliberate. This was intentional to limit a particular demographic and control them. I gave you the definition of the word earlier. By studying us, black, bronze, and brown people, studying them psychologically, to study human nature and the slave nature in particular, with a view to practical results. And many of them attained, here it is, astonishingly proficiently in this direction. You see, they controlled the slave. They owned the slave. They bought and sold slaves. Probably bigger than that was the psychological control. The master maintaining the master-slave relationship psychologically. It's still happening in our world. It's happening probably where you work or work now or have worked before. Wherever you have the majority culture, those being white, whites in America, 72% point something, 68 to 72%, depending on which school of thought you believe, exercising their employment privilege, if you will, over black, bronze, and brown people, 13 to 15% of the population, depending on what school of thought you support and believe. You're going to have this issue of marginalization where the supreme race deals with the inferior race, and there's a sort of control, a spirit of it that comes out by way of slave-master relationship. The master does the giving. The slave carries out the function. I even see it in professional athletics. Until you have black, bronze, and brown men and women who own professional teams. If you just have players who can make no decisions about their outcome, that's just slavery by another name, and you've made millionaires. They're still being, okay, I'll let that go. They had to deal not with earth, wood, and stone, but with people, with humans, even though they were not seen as equal humans. And they, by every regard, had known for their safety and prosperity, they had need to know the material on which they were to work. So these slave owners had to know the material, being the psyche, the morphe, the cerebellum, cerebrally. What makes black people, brown people, and bronze people tick? That mentality is still in our world today. It's in white-run, white evangelical churches where black people come and sit at the feet thinking that the ice, whatever the product is, of the white man is always colder than the ice, whatever the product is, of the black man, his equal, his counterpart. And there are some black people that always feel that they're better off than their other black counterparts when they are in affiliation with white people, because that is a conscious, that was an intentional and deliberate mentality of control that had to work if slavery was to continue. And if it was, in the words of Willie Lynch, to continue for 400 plus years, and he was prophetic in his projection. That was February 1999 by the author Kashif Malik Hassan L. conscious of the injustice and wrong, and this is an article I found by Frederick Douglass, conscious of the injustice and wrong, they were every hour, please hear this, perpetrating and knowing what they themselves would do were the victims of such wrongs. They were constantly looking for the first signs of dread retribution. So the white slave master knew that these people have an indigenous nature to be crafty, to be creative, black and brown, as well as bronze people, to be free ultimately. So in Frederick Douglass's eyes, he said they were conscious of the injustice and wrong. They were every hour perpetuating and knowing what they themselves would do were the victims of such wrongs. They were constantly looking for the first signs of dread retribution. So they expected some retribution. So how do I control this phenomenon, this demographic called the Negroid? How do I control him beyond the physical control that I'm inflicting upon this being? And here it is. I have it emboldened in my notes. They watched, therefore, with skilled and practiced eyes, and learned to read with great accuracy the state of mind and heart of the black churchman, of the slave through his sable face. Even though the faces of these black, bronze, and brown people in slavery were not engaging because they were hard worked. They were hard pressed. And so they could be 20, 30 years old, looking 60, 70, 80, 90, not good years, weathered, working in inclement conditions for years. These people were battered. But Frederick Douglass says, even though the faces were so unflinching, these white slavers learned to read the emotions, the psychology of the Negro, so as to continue to keep him hampered and restrained. The whips were one thing, but you'll recall, if they're killing slaves, slaves were property, slaves were insured, slaves were their key to the economic ongoing and rise. At one point, slavery as an industry was worth more than all the banks, all the railroad stations. I've done this on an earlier show. All of the commerce that was owned in the United States, slavery was bigger than everything the states were producing combined. So you have to understand that this black, bronze, and brown slave was very valuable. So killing him was losing economic value. So I must learn to control him other than these physical measures, which are taking him out of the economic pericope, if you will, story. Unusual sobriety, apparent abstraction, sullenness, and indifference. Indeed, any mood out of the common way afforded ground for suspicion and inquiry. So what Douglass is saying, Frederick Douglass, by the way, is saying that regardless of the look of the slave master, the white slave master, had to learn to read his psychology. Let's Make a Slave is a study of the scientific process of man breaking and slave making. I want you to hear that phraseology, man breaking and slave making. It describes the rationale and results of the Anglo-Saxons' ideas and methods of ensuring the master-slave relationship. Again, this is cited from the Black Liberation Library, 1970. Cardinal principles for making a Negro. Here it is. This was the mentality and the shaping of these yet to be United States, and it still is. And this is the mentality that has to be addressed by church leaders. And until then, like Moses said to the Pharaoh, we're not leaving behind the cattle, our economic ownership. We're not leaving behind the little children, and we're not leaving the women behind. Everybody has to come up. This has to be the come up. So the understanding what these masters were viewing as far as control. So here is something I discovered. Cardinal principles for making a Negro. For fear that our future generations may not understand the principles of making both horse and man, we lay down the art. So just as horses were wild in their natural environment, so they saw the black, bronze, and brown man as being wild and needing to be trained by them to be, here it is, wait for it, controlled. Controlled. Not by whip, but by mentality. For if we are to sustain our basic economy, we must break and tie both of the beasts together. The N-word, I'm going to use it for clarity. This is educational, YouTube. The nigger and the horse. That's not Niger. That's with two G's. The nigger and the horse. Now, I'm going to get this. YouTube, please give me a little latitude because this is educational, and this is a word that was being used at the time to convey or connote a certain psychological control. So stay with me. We understand that short-range planning in economics results in periodic chaos. No short-range plan here. So that to avoid turmoil in the economy, it requires us, white us, to have breadth and depth in long-range comprehensive planning, articulation, both skills and sharp perception. We lay down the following principles for long-range comprehensive economic planning, and I might add, for controlling psychologically the black, bronze, and brown person. A, or one, both horse and nigger are no good N-word to the economy in the wild or natural state. That was their mentality in the shaping of this country we call America. And when you hear certain parties say, make America great, okay, that's good. But when you use the last word again, this is the again to which they are referring. And so I never understood. I can never understand black, bronze, and brown people who vote to support people who don't support their causes. I don't understand pastors who are not aggressive in teaching people how to freely think. I don't understand you're giving your black, bronze, and brown dollars to support people who don't support you. Not only do they not support you, they have made their dissension against you apparent. It is not being cloaked any longer. Secondly, both must be broken and tied together for orderly production. Tied together. That's physically tying the man and the horse in his wild, the black man in his wild state, the wild stallion in his wild state, physically tying them together and seeing them, tying them together in terms of seeing the horse as no different from the black, bronze, and brown. For the orderly, thirdly, futures, special and particular attention must be paid to the female and the young offspring. See, this explains why the African American female in this country is the most educated of anyone, black, white, bronze, or otherwise, most educated. Check me out, fact check me. But yet, the farthest from matching dollar for dollar her white male counterparts, even though more educated. Control. You control the black female, bronze female, brown female. You control the household. You control them. And this is why you have mega rap artists who are black, bronze, and brown, whose labels are owned, whose masters are owned by white masters, both pun and no pun intended, when all of their, much of their raps, their lyrics of their raps are pejorative to black females, misogynistic, downright disrespectful. And you have black, bronze, and brown females who love the music, though being called the B word. I have something for you. Don't listen. Don't leave yet. And younger, they're coming into this same game. They don't care about it because it's psychological oppression. It's internalized. You've become stigmatized. You've been branded and you bought it. And nobody talks about it. No one wants to talk about it. So it's the breaking of the black female because what? She's the mother. She, you know, nobody can get into the earth. Black, bronze, or brown, and otherwise as well, but I'm concentrating on this demographic through any other means. But the woman, she is the portal, P-O-R-T-A-L. She's the doorway between the unseen realm and the seen realm. You're going to get here. So if you affect the mother, the potential mother, you affect the family, and you tear down an entire demographic. Fourthly, both must be crossbred to produce a variety and division of labor intentionally. Fifthly, both must be taught to respond to a particular new language. And finally, number six, psychological and physical instruction of containment must be created for the horse, the wild horse, and the wild black, bronze, or brown person. Containment, limiting their ability to rise. We hold the above six cardinal principles as truths to be self-evident based on the following discourse concerning the economics of breaking and tying the horse and the inward together, all inclusive of the six principles laid down above. Note, neither principle alone will suffice for good economics. All principles must be employed for the orderly good of the nation. You employ these six methods of control on the wild horse, tying him emotionally, psychologically, as well as physically to the black, bronze, and brown man. All six must be applied and constantly applied. And as well as it was then, so it is today, as it was then, so it is today. If the country, the nation, is going to make America great again for them, not us, church has to deal with this. White evangelicals, I'm calling you to deal with this. Black evangelicals, I'm calling you to deal with this. Jesus again said it, you shall know the truth, the objective truth about a matter within itself, and only the objective truth will make you free. And he so strongly felt about truth. He said that was St. John chapter 10. In St. John, I want to say 14, 6, and 7. He said, I am the way, the way. I am the truth, and I am the life. And so here it is, the light. And so accordingly, both a wild horse and a wild or natural inward is dangerous if captured, for they will have a tendency to seek their customary freedom. Starts up here, and it responds in their physical freedom. And in doing so, might kill you in your sleep. You cannot rest. They sleep while you're awake. This is their psychological purview of the black, bronze, and brown person. This is why confinement, and control is necessary. Here's their perception after studying our traits. They sleep while you're awake, and they are awake while you are asleep. They are dangerous near the family house, and it requires too much labor to watch them away from the house. Above all, you cannot get them to work in the natural state of desiring to be free or not being controlled by the master. Hence, both the horse and the inward again must be broken. That is, break them from one form. Here it is. Wait for it. Of mental life to another. Keep the body. Take the mind. Keep the body. Confine the body. And then deliberately monkey with. Take control of the mind. In other words, break the will to resist. Break the will to rise. Break the will to trust anyone but us. Break their will to believe anyone is the perpetuator of truth but us. Now, the breaking process is the same for the horse and the N-word, only slightly varying in degrees. But as we said before, there is an art in long-range planning. You must keep your eye and thoughts on the female and the offspring of the horse and the N-word. A brief discourse in offspring development will shed light on the key to sound economic principles. Pay little attention to the generation of original breaking, but concentrate on future generations. And you wonder why we are perpetuating our crimes against each other. When we have no trust, while the economic dollar has little life in our community, it has grandiose life outside of our community. It lasts 6 hours. We trade a dollar, a business dollar, within our community for 6 hours. Asian community, 14 days. Jewish community, 18 days or so. Well, the Asian community, it may be 28 days. Jewish community, 14, 15 days. Africans, 6 hours. And it's worse than that. For example, take the case of the wild stud horse, a female horse and an already infant horse, and compare the breaking process with the two N-word males in their natural state. A pregnant N-word woman with her infant offspring, take the stud horse, break him for, here it is, limited confinement. Completely break the female horse until she becomes very gentle. Whereas you or anybody, here it is, can ride her in comfort. Breed the mare and the stud, the female horse and the male horse, the stud, the mare, the stud, until you have the desired offspring. This is the disposition of their psychological understanding and appreciation, or lack thereof, of the black, bronze, and brown person in this country. That mentality still exists, and it exists in white America largely. And the stigma of it exists in black America and even in the church. And no one wants to talk about it. It's never been dealt with in the church. And because the church has dropped the ball in Jesus saying, comparing the church to the light of the world, you take the light out of the church, then the world is dark. If you're the salt of the earth, you take the salt out of the church and there's no influence in the earth. And so you have elections like the 2020 election, and you have false prophets who have been among us and we've held in high esteem and supported their ministries, and they've come out in uncloaked, unrestrained ways to support a man who is narcissistic in every way, who seeks, allow me to get finished here. I'm just going to drop that down. When it comes to break the uncivilized N-word, use the same process, but vary in degree and step up the pressure so as to do a complete reversal of the mind. I have about 5 minutes. Take the meanest and most restless N-word, strip him of his clothes in front of the remaining male N-words, the female, the N-word infant, tar and feather him, tie each leg to a different horse in opposite directions. You talk about the heinousness of slavery. Set him on fire and beat both horses to pull him apart in front of the remaining N-words. And someone had the nerve to say, white evangelical pastor, and seconded the motion by other popular white evangelical pastors, of whom we know that slavery, black slavery, was a blessing, and white privilege is a blessing. when you're pulling black people apart by tying their legs to opposite horses and setting the horse's tail on fire and beat the horse and pull the black man apart in front of his family and other black people to control the mind. Yes, that was a heinous action, but what was the bigger picture? Control, control, one more time. Control, because God has made you to be free and God has given you unlimited potential, and it cannot be restrained until it is emotionally and psychologically controlled. Here it is. The next step is to take a bull whip and beat the remaining N-word male to the point of death in front of the female and the infant. Don't kill him, but put the fear of God in him, of us, for he can be useful for future breeding. Nothing else, but I'm going to use his seed to breed him like the mare and the stud, because he's economically valuable to me. If I maintain him psychologically as a slave in his mind, I get the stigma in his mind. I have to get his mind controlled. First, control control by use of creating and usage of an especially derogatory term. Now, I'm going to use this word. YouTube, you're sensitive to this, and I know it, but you allow it for rappers and you allow it for lyricists. So please allow it. And it's the word nigger. And I'll use the N-word expression from this point on. Nigger. The use of the N-word, from whence did that word come? Now, I did the research. What was the purpose of that word? Why was the master so deliberate in using this word that, based on my research, exists in no other language other than American English? It was the Southern plantation owner who comprised this word. It exists in no other linguistic arrangement, no other language, as I could research. Has this word and the mentality that goes with it ever been addressed by white evangelicals and white America at large? Arizona State University professor Neil A. Lester states the following regarding the use of the N-word, and I quote, "It starts with the word, but it becomes about other ideas and realities that go beyond words." Man, that is powerful. The use of the N-word starts with the word, but it becomes about other ideas and realities that go beyond words. How did the N-word become such a scathing insult? That's my question. Dr. Lester, to that question, states, "We know, at least in history I've looked at, that the word started off as just a descriptor, Negro, quote unquote, with no value, not plus or minus, attached to it. We know that as early as the 17th century, and that's the 1600s, Negro evolved to N-word as intentionally derogatory, working on the mind. The word is inextricably linked with violence and brutality on black psyches, the mind, and derogatory aspersions cast on black bodies. No degree of appropriating can rid it of that blood-soaked history," he states. "No word conveyed the depth," please hear this, "of internalized oppression." I've defined it for you in the early part of the show. "Indoctrination into accepting the slave's supposed inferiority more than the N-word." That's why it was being used, to control him psychologically. "The world laid bare a worldview that held black folk as a lower order of being, and it was conveyed by the use of the N-word because this was psychologically intended. Signals, the N-word signals disdain and deep-seated dislike," please hear this, toward fellow black folk from the perspective of other black folk. So not only was the white master using it, but then the Negro began to use the term, and he projected the same limiting concept. So, and I've done the research and I don't have time to touch it tonight, so that the Negro began to internalize it and see himself as lesser than his white counterpart. So now we have spiritual white leaders who don't use the N-word, at least not around us, but their control is from the same stoking point as using the N-word. I had questions for you, and I don't have the teaching time to get to it tonight, but I do thank you for yours. Here's the final close. Business philosopher Jim Rohn says, sincerity, and I say the same thing every show, is not a true test of truth. We must not make this mistake. He must be right. He's so sincere. He goes on to say, it is possible to be sincerely wrong. We can only judge truth by truth and sincerity by sincerity. Just as there is a time to keep silent, there is a time to speak. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 7, a time to rend, a time to sow, a time to keep silence, and a time to speak. And I may go so far as to say, now is that time. We cannot be silent from our various platforms of influence any longer. The cost is too great. Silence is golden, some would say, and I would say, and I say, only until one's family and friends are negatively affected by wrongdoing. Others would say, silence is great, and I would say to them, until someone's voice is necessary to save your life or corroborate your innocence. Silence is compromise. Silence is complicity with erroneous thinking. It's your part. You complement erroneous thinking when you're silent until you correct it by a voice. Silence is agreement with sanitized, whitewashed history. Silence is co-signing with control, racist, bigoted, and supremacy mentality. Silence is equity and fairness in reverse. Silence robs supremacy, also the supremacist minded person, of ever hearing truth and having the opportunity to change. Silence is the voice of continuous ethnic mistreatment. Silence is validating inferior treatment. Silence is the approval of being objectified and maligned. Silence is often mistaken for agreement and consent. Silence is the devastation of a child being uncontrolled, untrained, and undisciplined by its silent parents. You know what happens there. It's the same effect. Silence is one level of maintaining cloaked and perpetuating, I'm going to add that, cloaked ignorance. These are all my statements and my observations about silence. I give them to you every week and add to them occasionally. Silence is liberty and justice in their end. Liberty and justice end with our silence. Till next week at 6:30, at the 6:30 hour, Monday night. Merry Christmas to you and yours. Please share, subscribe, comment, like, follow, help us to grow the channel and consequently get the message out. We appreciate your time, and until next week, as at this very same time, please enjoy the truth as it liberates and makes us free. Thank you. I'll see you then.